الله الرحمن الرحيم، والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and may I wish you the greatest of greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I have with me this evening a very distinguished gentleman. I don't think he needs further introduction to Maldivians right now. Dr. Abul Amin Abdelal Phillips, who has been gracious enough to come to the Maldives and enlighten us on certain aspects of Islam that I think I feel that this country needs. So instead of going into your background as a Muslim scholar or as even a human being, I think one of the best things to do would be to welcome you, Dr. Bilal, and may I call you my brother, to this country which happens to be, fortunately for all of us, 100% Muslim. And that's a rare thing in this world today. And because we are that, we take extra pleasure in welcoming you to this wonderful country of ours. My brother, please tell me a little bit about yourself and why you have come to the Maldives.
Well, of course, I'm originally from Jamaica, which, as some have asked me here, and we're not really familiar with where is Jamaica, I should just add that it is between North America and South America in the Caribbean Sea, and it's a small island, but it has quite a bit of notoriety in the West.
I think the only thing that we're familiar with is Bob Marley, but that's an entirely different kettle of fish, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, that usually rings a bell in some people's minds. I sometimes have to bring up Bob Marley to clarify where I'm coming from. But also, of course, in the sports scene now, the top 100-meter specialist, Hussein Bolt, is Jamaican. You know, the top runners, the female runners right now in the Olympics and the world top sprinters are Jamaicans. So they have had a history of a presence on the world scale in athletics, in cricket also. This is another
right.
area.
And I read somewhere that you actually grew up in Canada.
Yes, my family migrated to Canada when I was quite small, so I didn't really remember that much of Jamaica, except after I went back and renewed my acquaintance with Jamaica, I got to know it better. But yes, I grew up in Toronto and finished my schooling there, but I went and moved to Malaysia with my family. They had moved there. My parents were both educators, teachers, and they were helping the Malaysians with their education system. And they spent about 5 years in Malaysia, in East Malaysia, and I lived there for about 3 years myself. Not a Muslim at that point in time.
Okay, and you became a Muslim at the age of 25?
Yes, after I went back to Canada to university, I majored in biochemistry in university and got caught up in student politics, went from Christianity into communism, because Christianity was really nominal Christianity. So communism would seem to offer opportunities to change the world and make things better. I got caught up in that for a while until I realized that it really didn't change things for the better. So I started looking again, and alhamdulillah, Allah presented Islam for me at that time, and I accepted it.
And here you are.
Yes, alhamdulillah.
And you've been to the Philippines, you work in the Arab world, and you've become an international personality. How do you feel?
Well, I mean, it's a great blessing to be in the position to be able to help convey the message of Islam to so many people. You know, it's when you've tried to do it on a small scale, and you compare that to being able to reach out to so many people in so many places, it's a wonderful feeling, you know, knowing that, you know, this is what God wanted for me, and it's a wonderful opportunity, and I just ask God to bless me for whatever good I've done through this channel.
Alhamdulillah. I have a focus topic this evening, by the way, and that's drugs. Sadly, something that has raised its ugly head in the Maldives would be the drug problem. Now, according to some experts, and some of them real experts, some of them self-styled, they keep saying that the drug problem is on the increase in the Maldives. Now, what would you say about the existence of such a problem in a country which is 100% Muslim Islamic?
Well, I would say that it is something which occurred even in the time of the Prophet, may God's peace and blessing be upon him.
So,
you know, even in his period, where Islam dominated in the latter part of his life, I mean, there were people who were caught up in drugs. You know, it was alcohol in those days. So it is something which society can never really free itself from. But the main efforts should be to minimize the impact and to reform those who are caught up in it. You know, to tackle it effectively in these times, one needs to know, you know, what are the reasons, what are the causes which have led to it. But
I sometimes tend to think of some of the so-called reasons as excuses even. What would you say to that?
Well, I would say that ignorance of true Islamic teachings and its practice is a real reason. You know, it's not an excuse, it's a real reason. People not knowing, you know, Islam, as we said, though Maldives is a 100% Muslim country, but we have to say, to a large degree, this is nominal Islam. You know, where it's lip service Islam, meaning that people would say, if you ask them, are you Muslim? They say, yes, I'm Muslim. But then, if you look into their individual lives, to what degree has Islam impacted on their lives? We have to say it is, you know, it's quite limited.
Well, if you look at the mosques, they are full.
Well, I don't know if they're full, but I mean, the ones that I've prayed in, there are good numbers there. I do respect those numbers, and it's good, it's pleasing to see that. I've seen similar numbers in Chennai, in India, where Muslims are only 20% of the total population. You know,
right.
So full, not quite. You know, it hasn't reached that stage. I think there is an awakening to Islam in these recent last decade. You know, there's a more of a consciousness, but there's still a long way to go for people to really get back to really what Islam is. You know, I've talked to educators here, those involved in the educational system of the country. You know, those involved in various levels of that educational system, and it's clear that the infusion of Islam into the educational system remains according to the colonial model of separation of religion from worldly affairs, you know, as the Christian statement says.
Would you cite that as one of the reasons for the drug problem, the separation?
I would cite it as one of the reasons, because that connection hasn't been made. We still have that separation. Islamic studies is something separate, and then we have our worldly studies. And worldly studies, for the most part, the globalized version, which we're practicing here, is has become demoralized. Morality has been taken out of it, and it's a secular system. So the moral foundation in education, which should be there in the Islamic educational system, is missing. So where that moral foundation is missing, people in times of need, emotional, psychological need, then they reach out for whatever is available. And if drugs are available, that's what they...
So this business of lack of entertainment or cramped living quarters or separated families, that sort of thing, that's just excuses.
I would say are excuses. I mean, they compound the issue.
Uh-huh.
But the fundamental issue, if people are aware really, practically, that, you know, this is something forbidden, and why it is forbidden. See, if our teaching of Islam is only haram and halal, it is everything is, and they hear every time it's haram, this one's haram, that one's haram, there's no understanding behind it. See, then it is just, you know, as they say, what is forbidden becomes attractive.
Okay.
Because there is no reasoning behind it. So that's why I say it goes back to the educational system. Mm-hmm. That educational system of the past, where Muslims for centuries ruled so many parts of the world, and the alcohol or the drug problem was kept at a minimum. Not that it didn't exist, but it kept its ugly head down. It didn't dominate those societies. Why? Because of the integration of Islamic knowledge with the secular knowledge, we call secular knowledge or acquired knowledge, you know, in such a way that people didn't feel that separation between what is religious and what is secular.
Right. So, and by the way, the questions that I might be asking my brother Bilal might be a bit controversial, but just for the purpose of enlightenment, why not? Brother, tell me, you've said that the drugs problem mostly would be created by lack of understanding in what we should, the strengthening of our faith. Do you have any solutions in mind?
Well, the basic solution requires a revisiting of the educational system as it exists, you know, where educators have to be clear on what the goals of education are. You know, we have inherited a system from the colonial times, and this has been perpetuated without actually analysis from an Islamic perspective. So we need our educators here to re-look at this and look to see how we can bring values education back into place, you know, where moral messages are given in every class that is taught. You know, a relationship with Islam is there established. So the student doesn't feel any dichotomy between his Islam and worldly affairs, that it's all linked. You know, and
in other words, this will have to start right at nursery or even primary school levels.
Absolutely. I mean, we can't fool ourselves. This is, once this has been taken out, once this has been removed, then this is the impact. And this is what the West is facing. I mean, this drug problem is not unique to Maldives. I mean, let's go back to Western society. I mean, that's what they're observing on the television and in the media. Drugs have become a massive problem. You know?
Do you sometimes have this strange feeling deep at the bottom of your stomach, a bit of your guts, that there are some people, vague figures out there, deliberately targeting us, almost marketing the drugs onto us? Do you sometimes have this feeling?
Well, I don't doubt that, you know, there are elements who utilize the drugs as a means of controlling populations, you know, undermining societies, you know, for their own interests of control. I don't really spend too much time trying to figure out who it is, because, you know, these shady figures are shady. That's why they're shady.
Exactly.
You know? So, but no doubt, you know, this thing is not accidental. It's not happening. Even in America, you know, when people analyze where the drugs are coming from, who are benefiting from all these, I mean, there are people behind this. This is not something accidental. It's not just in the poor segment of the societies. No, it is coming from people who are very much established in the society, who have personal interests.
And would you be convinced that strong faith would be the ultimate solution?
Well, we see that strong faith has been. If we go to countries, say for example like Egypt, where, you know, say it's 80% Muslim, and in Egypt you have breweries.
Yes.
Where, you know, alcohol is produced, okay? So it means that anybody who wants it, there are no rules that says Muslims can't go into bars. It's there. But yet, the vast majority of the population doesn't engage in it. They're teetotalers. We are known as teetotalers around the world. How did we manage to do that when America, for example, they banned alcohol for 11 years? You know, the period
the
of prohibition.
Yes.
Yes, for 11 years they banned it. Why? Because they knew the harm was obvious. It was clear.
But that didn't work there.
It didn't work. They have forced to bring it back in. You know? Why? Because the faith wasn't there. You see, to try to impose it externally without people having a conviction, a commitment. All the people who work with Alcoholics Anonymous, you know, who have their 12 points, how to break drug addiction. Number one is what? You've got to connect to a higher power.
Okay.
Because you can't do it yourself.
All right. And that's what we're here for.
Yes.
Do you have any special messages for people out there in our audience, you know, who would like you to tell them personally that if they are drug addicts, how to get out of it?
Well, the program of Alcoholics Anonymous is clear, and Islam offered that from the very beginning, that, you know, the only way out is with the help of God. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's there for you. If you turn to Him sincerely and ask for His help, then He will help you. But you have to be sincere about it. And then you have to take steps. Of course, it has to be two, you know, two aspects. There's one, the one of the faith, where one links with God for His help, and then the other hand, one has to take definite and clear steps to end the addiction. But one has to know that it's possible. You know, it's not. Though one might feel that, you know, you can't give it up, etc., but you must know that God, Allah, has not prescribed or put you in any situation which you cannot handle. So you are capable. You have to go back to that famous saying, I can do it. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just a question of how and when. So we need to get back to the hows and the whens and go ahead and do it.
Now, you've personally seen some of this happening, in the sense that, I mean, obviously you lived in different parts of the world, and you've seen this, drugs and alcohol. Which do you think is the greater problem, drugs or alcohol?
Well, I think they're both. You know, in the impact of alcohol is probably greater. There's greater damage in the society worldwide. Drugs, because alcohol is a drug. Mm-hmm. You know, so when we say drugs and alcohol, we're really taking alcohol out of the category of drugs.
But isn't there a subtle difference? Like, one is very much underground and the other one is openly advertised.
Yeah, this is the problem. Because by people making a distinction between drugs and alcohol, you know, it's like alcohol is the drug which is okay, but we just need to control it. But,
okay.
Yeah. But is it really? You know, it really falls together in the same bag. It is something which Islam prohibited 1,400 years ago without any recourse. Mm-hmm. You know, there's no exception in here. You know, we don't have what they call, you know, we could say socially acceptable social drinking, for example. No.
The term exists.
The term exists, but from an Islamic perspective, it is definitely out, because that the evil of alcohol and drugs in general is so great that Islam forbade it outright.
Exactly. You know? So looking for a solution, you said it can be solved at the school level with the national curriculum and so on. What role do parents play, you think?
Well, of course, you know, parent education of parents through the television, you know, programs which can give them a better understanding of the roots of the problem and understand, you know, their own religion in itself, and give them guidance as to how to handle it. Because, of course, oftentimes parents who find their children addicted don't know how to respond. I mean, it's, you know, what do you do? This person is caught up in this way. And oftentimes the reaction is violent, or, you know, and it doesn't make it any better, it just makes it worse.
Exactly.
So, I mean, there needs to be drug rehabilitation programs which are firmly in place, bringing in people who are trained. You know, and this is where I even suggested to some who mentioned this to me that, you know, there are people in America, Muslims, who work in the prisons and work in drug rehabilitation, you know, who can come and, you know, be sensitive to the fact that this is a Muslim country. Because bringing people who are involved in drug rehabilitation who have no consciousness about Islam, I mean, they may be introducing things which, you know, on one hand it may be benefiting, on the other hand we may be also creating further harm, you know.
Side effects of the pill, as it were.
Yes. So it is important that, you know, where they may rely more on counter drugs, methadone and these other things, mm-hmm. as a solution, where from an Islamic perspective, we don't try to take them from one drug to another drug, we try to take them off the drug altogether. You know, so differences in approach would require that we try to get experts who are from Islamic backgrounds, so that we have a culturally sensitive program, you know. And then, of course, you know, even on the highest levels, one has to now rethink and relook at, you know, how drugs are handled, you know, on a state level. This has to be looked at also, that perhaps they have to put more curbs, etc., you know, to protect this society from its harm.
Mm-hmm. So it'll have to be a blanket thing, like nip them at the source, while at the same time make sure that you create less demand, perhaps.
Mm-hmm. And educate.
Mm-hmm. And that, it all takes us back to the issue of our faith in our Creator. Everything.
Yes.
Basically. Mm-hmm. So that's whether it's drugs or any other problem.
Sure, social, otherwise. But we know that ultimately there is a solution, because Islam does have the solution for all of these problems. And that is the thing which attracted me most and made me want to become a Muslim, was the comprehensiveness of Islam, where nothing is left out. You know, no aspect of human life is untouched by Islamic teachings.
My brother, you have touched all of us this evening. So thank you very much for having been with us. It's been a pleasure. And we have a great tradition in this country of welcoming our guests here. So once again, welcome to the Maldives. And thank you so much for having enlightened us this evening. And hopefully we'll see you again next week. Thank you so much.
My pleasure to be here. And I really appreciate the opportunity to share. And Maldives has been very, very excellent hosts for me. And the welcome that I have received here, I can hardly find another country that has welcomed me as the Maldives has.
Thank you once again. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for spending some of your time with us this evening. Hope to see you next week. My name is Waheed. See you soon. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.